EMF radiation. Is it harmless or is it the silent killer? Today, we're gonna take a look at the potential risks of EMF radiation, just how much your solar gear is giving off, and the general consensus on its dangers. So grab your tinfoil hats and let's jump in. On a serious note, we have no idea if EMF radiation causes cancer or any type of harm. We've heard information kind of on both sides. Some say it does, some say it doesn't. Even different agencies within the World Health Organization have different opinions. Some say it's possibly harmful. And another one we found says that EMF radiation can cause fatigue, headache, decreased learning ability, and cognitive impairment. So they don't even really know what's going on. How should we? Honestly, it probably causes some sort of issues, but how much? We're not gonna know until our generation is all old and riddled with new diseases and cancers. The reality is everything is bad for you if you get too much of it, even water. Water is literally what keeps you alive. If you drink too much of it, you die. It's called water toxemia. Google it. The point is, look, we're not scientists or doctors, we're solar guys, and today we're gonna test our solar gear. So to do our testing, Josh brought over his tinfoil hat-o-meter. This is a EMF tester. It registers electromagnetic field. This one measures in Gauss.
A unit of measurement for magnetic flux density or the number of magnetic field lines per square centimeter.
What he said. Basically, this reads the electromagnetic waves coming off of things. Anything under 4 is considered safe, maybe. Anything over 4 is considered dangerous, maybe, depends whose information you trust. And so we started with the most obvious thing we could think of, the power lines outside. Josh ran across the street and just literally held this thing up above his head, and standing on the road underneath an intersection of power lines, this was picking up a 3.6. So it's not quite a 4 where it's dangerous, but initially, it was already a very interesting thing for us because just walking around on the road, you're already exposed to this just from the power lines. On our side of that street, the power lines are actually buried. So we did the same thing, kind of walked by the power meter, the big green box. We have one actually in our front yard. And same kind of thing, as you're walking up to it, you can notice that the meter gets higher and higher and higher. You do actually pass through a danger zone as you pass the box, and then it goes away. You'll notice though, if you bring this right up close, as you kind of get right up to that box, the readings do get decently high, nowhere near what we're gonna see later in the video though. But just seeing the power line results, a hydro field or one of these things, I can imagine that it's probably not good. Even once that power enters the house, it's only high within a couple of feet. The grand theme here that you guys are gonna start noticing is like distance is a huge key. So once that power comes into the house, as soon as you get kind of close to the panel, you notice the numbers start going up again, but a few feet away, it drops significantly and you're pretty safe. Even right here, right now, it's reading flat zeros. Next up, we tested the Wi-Fi router. This thing actually blew our mind. Not that it was the most powerful reading ever, but the radius was like over 2 feet where you're still within the danger zone, which is makes sense because it's got to blast the Wi-Fi throughout your entire house, but it was a lot worse than we thought. And it actually scared me because my Wi-Fi router is in my living room beside a chair. I'm gonna need to address that and move it. The good news is our office here at the lab is about 15 feet away from the router and it's reading completely zero. So again, it's just a distance thing. Even our microwave gave off a pretty good amount. It was in the hundreds. Even though our microwave is like brand new, the range was still about 4 feet before you exited the danger zone. And Josh said that his microwave at home is much older and he's tested it and it's got at least a 6 foot danger zone, which again, just makes you think a lot of people have, you know, induction microwaves above their stove. They're microwaving food while they're cooking food on the stove and your head is literally this far from the microwave that's giving off a ton of radiation. And now for the big one, cell phones, AirPods, and like smartwatches, things that everybody's wearing all the time that we probably aren't even considering, was surprisingly less than we thought. Your phone, sure, it may give off a reading. Only really when you're touching it though, like as soon as you get kind of any distance between you and the phone, it's generally not that bad, but this also depends on your service. If your phone has really good service, it's not gonna be struggling and putting out as much field to pick up on things. If you have terrible service, it's actually much, much worse. Also, like if I was on the phone right now, it would get significantly worse. Something like your Apple Watch, it's just on you constantly scanning your wrist. That can't be good for you at all. That's peaking at, it peaks at only 8, which actually isn't terrible, but pretty much all day. Like I don't, like it makes you question your actions. And AirPods we actually found to be completely fine. We actually couldn't even get the AirPods to set an alarm off. Good news on that to people that wear AirPods all day at work. Our backyard science shows that it's much lower than we anticipated. And one thing you'll notice with the cell phone, though, is it's very random. Whenever the phone decides to ping a Wi-Fi router, ping a tower, it's getting a text, it's always searching for something. And whenever something's coming in, or it just randomly decides to look for something on its scheduled search, it can fluctuate a lot. So while the phones don't give off a lot all the time, they can give off some pretty significant pulses every now and then. And for fun, we even tested some cars. Obviously, if you had an EV, this would be significantly different. But even in my just regular Subaru sedan, in the footwell, where all the wiring harnesses, I guess, are coming up and together and through the firewall, this thing's reading about a 7 to 8, which is pretty crazy. The gauge cluster, another area that's giving off a ton of radiation, as you get 10 inches away, it pretty much drops to zero, but more than I thought there would be inside of a car, considering all of it is really low voltage. The good news with the car is, other than your feet, the rest of your body is pretty much at zero. With an EV, you might be driving around a microwave. We gotta get one to test. And so now that we had our nice baseline of other examples to compare it to, we decided to jump in on the solar gear. So we started with our 6000 XP. This thing basically had, at the time, about 1,000 watts of solar running in from the backyard solar panels, and it was powering our mini split, our heat pump outside. So it wasn't doing a ton of work. There was no grid power going into it at that time, but just doing its thing, it was actually giving off a lot more than we anticipated. There's spots that were close to 400-500 mg in certain areas. Again, within about 2 feet is basically the safe zone. Once you get about 2 feet away, it kind of stops warning you get within that zone. It's extremely noticeable around the wires. The battery wires running from the battery into the bottom were insanely high. They spiked over 1,000. And again, they're like a 2-2.5 foot radius to get out of that zone. And when you have grid power turned on into the inverter, it gets insanely worse. So it just makes you kind of consider, if you have that in your trailer, your RV or your van, you're doing van life, or anywhere, your tiny home or just your regular home, and that's in a space where you're kind of right near, you're working or you're sleeping or whatever, that makes you think for sure. And something actually interesting, we found like a hot spot on the outside of the inverter, one specific area that was giving off like 400-500 mg. When you pull all the covers off, you realize that's where two of the battery wires that run in go through a breaker and then they turn. And there's also a bunch of science going on behind there. You can tell wherever energy is flowing, that's where you're always gonna find your area with like the most field. We also went ahead and tested the Power Pro battery that was actually giving power to the 6000 XP. That was significantly lower than we thought it would be. It was really not much coming off the front. Your safe zone's pretty close. The sides, though, that is where all your battery connections and stuff are. That gave off a pretty good reading. And again, you're like at least a foot to get outside of the safe zone. The thing that really floored us was a power station. We tested multiple different ones, from a cheaper one, an OUPES, to a really expensive EcoFlow Delta Pro Ultra, and then just a regular Jackery 1000. And all of them gave off way more than we were anticipating. Basically, anytime these units are working, they give off a ridiculous amount. The Jackery just plugged in with a 700 watt load running, we saw numbers over 1200 mg, which is more than we see on the wires coming into our house from the grid. That's insane. And when you go ahead and plug it into power, the number even increases, so you're now charging that unit. On the OUPES, all we were doing was charging it. It was just sitting there charging from the wall, then it was giving off over a 500 reading. And even the Delta Pro Ultra doing nothing, the battery gives off quite a bit. It was almost 200 just from the battery wherever you put the meter, which was really weird. It really made me think, because I've gone camping multiple times before where I ended up sleeping literally with my head butted up against my Jackery. And that is terrifying to think of right now. So the key takeaway here is, distance is your friend. Whether you're trying to stay about 3 feet away from a power station, I know 2 feet is like the safe zone, so I would stay another foot away just to be safe. Whether you're trying to stay 3 feet away from a power station, 10 feet away from your Wi-Fi router, or 10 feet away from your old ass microwave, distance is the key to all of this. And I think that's also the thing that people are considering the least if you're building a van or putting a solar system in your RV. You might not think like, oh, I'm just gonna tuck this wire right here because it fits. In most cases, we found that you're generally safe. Like I said, just sitting here right now, we're getting a zero reading. What you should just be conscious of is your distance to these items and how long you're spending in that distance, if you even believe any of it is bad for you at all. In our opinion, it's better safe than sorry. If you know something might be dangerous for you, why not just err on the side of caution? It's better than getting halfway through your life and finding out it's over. At least you cuddled with your Jackery every night. It did make me reconsider where I'm going to place things in my house, especially the solar stuff. Consider it when you're building or rearranging or whatever. Make sure you guys like this video. If you found it helpful at all, leave some ideas, other things that you want to see us test down below. And that is all we got for you guys. I'll catch you in the next one. Thank you so much for watching. Peace out and stay charged.